Peter, Peter got it worked out. Technology.
With a call to Michael.
There you go. Geeks are everywhere. We just got to find them. Hallelujah. Hello. Appreciate y'all being here this morning. I've got a, I don't know, it seemed like a weird message to me, but trust in the Lord. I had two people this week and one last week talking to me about the Holy Spirit, wondering, do I have the Holy Spirit? Not me. Do they have the Holy Spirit? They're asking me that if they have. And I just think there's confusion. And we have people that are born again, filled with the Holy Ghost, but living outside of the means that God has provided for them. And I think part of that is because the enemy tries to convince them they don't have everything that they need to operate in the Lord. And so that's what I'm going to talk about this morning, because that's what I feel like the Lord gave me. But before we get to that, I thought I'd just remind you that there's a new restaurant in town. I don't know if any of you have tried it yet. It's called Karma. They don't have a menu. You just get what you deserve. I won't be dying there in the near future. I've got a friend that works at the bank, and he lost his job. And some woman had to ask him to check her balance, and so he pushed her over. Sorry. I can't wait to tell that to my anybody know what you call an alligator in a vest? Come on, Peter, I know. An investigator. Okay, I'll spare you too much more damage. I don't see any too many. You
know, we got plenty of space on the memory.
Yeah, I know. The two blondes. Now I have a thing about blondes, good or bad. It's just, you know, we have this kind of way of looking at blondes, dealing with them. Well, two blondes were walking in the woods when they came across some tracks. And it's deer tracks, the first one said. And the second one said, no, it's bear tracks. And they got into a heated argument. No, it's deer tracks. And then, no, it's bear tracks. Well, they were still arguing when the train hit. Feel free to use any of these. Others were humiliated right along with me. Okay, thank the Lord. Amen. Glad God's in a good mood. I've got several scriptures here to start with, just to kind of hopefully set things up a little better. And I'd like to begin, Peter, with 1 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 19. 1 Corinthians 6. Him that overcometh will I make a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go no more out, and I will write upon him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, which is New Jerusalem, which cometh down out of heaven from my God, and I will write upon him my new name. Praise the Lord. 1 John 5, verses 4 and 5. So, if you overcome, you're a part of the temple. You're established in the temple, right? And he says, whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world. And this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. Who is he that overcometh the world? But he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God. Amen. If you believe that, you're in the temple. You are the temple. Praise the Lord. Okay, last scripture here to begin with, Luke chapter 11 and verse 13. If ye then, being evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to them that ask him? So we know from these scriptures and others, obviously, that God lives in us as believers. We are his holy temple. Amen. We are his home in the earth. Praise God. John 14, verse 23. John said unto him, if a man loves me, he will keep my words. This is to what Mary was saying in the preliminaries. If we love the Lord, if we believe the Lord, this is how we're going to respond to situations, by his words, by what he says, not ours. He said, I only say what I hear my Father say. We're only supposed to be saying the same thing. Amen. And if a man loves me, he'll keep my words, and my Father will love him, and we will come unto him and make our abode with him. Praise the Lord. And that's the reason that Paul wrote to the church at Corinth in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 16.
Well, that's my cue.
1 Corinthians 3, 16. Sorry. I'm
trying to watch a couple things.
You couldn't see me. Wait, come back here. Know ye not that you are the temple of God, and that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you? Okay, so here's the question that I've been asked a lot of times, but just recently in the last couple weeks. And the question, or I should say probably the question behind the question, is a wondering. And the wondering is kind of like this. If I haven't had a dramatic encounter with the Spirit, if he hasn't met me in some interesting or weird or strange or obvious way, then have I really got the Holy Spirit? Now, you may think, talking about. Listen, there's people out there that struggle with this every single day. And I can tell you, when I received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, it was more about speaking in tongues than it was anything else. Now, I received the baptism of the Holy Spirit and did speak in tongues, but I knew people. In fact, a good friend of mine, in fact, they taught, and we just heard from them in the other day. He's about 10, 12, 15 years older than that. And they taught us a Bible study before we actually started going to church or got involved in the church or received the And he told me that, and I don't doubt that the story is true. He's an honest man. He spent over a year seeking the Holy Ghost. Now, any of you that came out of a Pentecostal background know what I'm talking about. Night after night, service after service, people wailing and crying and begging and pleading for the Holy Spirit. When in fact, what they were really wanting to do was speak in tongues, and they didn't think that it was them that was going to speak in tongues, that somehow God was going to come in and just take their tongue and make them do it. I'm telling you, if you're born again, you can speak in tongues. All you got to do is open your mouth and let it come out.
Amen.
There's not anything more to it. But you know what I mean? It's just a sign. It's an evidence of what you have. Amen. It's kind of like baptism. Baptism doesn't save anybody. It's just an outward expression of our faith, of our belief in what Jesus has done for us. It's a symbolic thing that shows that we identify with the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ. And Scripture actually tells us baptism saves nobody. But it's like Abraham being circumcised. The circumcision didn't change anything about Abraham other than the physical thing. But it was a sign of his obedience or his faith in God. So it's the same kind of thing. So here he says, know ye not you are the temple of God, and that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you. So here's the question. Do I really have it? Because I didn't experience some physical thing. I didn't feel this. I'm talking about in generic terms here. You might have been in a service or maybe you've been in a revival somewhere or watched Christian TV where people have they're shaking, you know, they pass out, they fall down, praying in tongues, and yet nothing happened to you. You're watching it and you're wondering, why not me? Why didn't I feel that? Why didn't I get knocked out? Why didn't I just become overwhelmed and speak in tongues? But nothing happened to you. So the question that you ask is, do I have the Spirit? I mean, look, I'm looking at the people that obviously have it because they're going through all this stuff and I'm not feeling it, I'm not seeing it, I'm not experiencing it. And if you've asked that question or you ask yourself, do I have the Holy Spirit? I want to answer you today. If you are a believer in Jesus Christ, you have the Holy Spirit. If you accept Christ as your Savior, you have the Spirit of God. Amen?
Amen.
Every Christian, whether they have had a dramatic physical encounter or not, the Spirit is living inside of them right now.
Amen.
And this is what the Bible teaches. And if you're still wondering, do I or does they or do they or does this person or that person, here's a couple of tests you can take. And the first one is 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 3. But I think sometimes we just overthink stuff. We let religion get in there and kind of try to twist things and manipulate things, and then we get to overthinking, and the next thing you know, we're judging, this person got it, I got it, they got it, I didn't do this, I didn't do that, this didn't happen to me. Wherefore, I give you to understand that no man speaking by the Spirit of God called Jesus accursed, and that no man can say that Jesus is the Lord but by the Holy Spirit. So if you're confessing Jesus, if you're saying, I believe he's my Savior, he's God in the flesh, he came and died for me, you're saying that by the Holy Spirit. Your natural man doesn't say that. The natural person doesn't agree with that. They may question it. They may wonder about it. They may think, gee, that would be neat if it was true. But if you're saying that, you can only say that by the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
If you're saying it, you can only say that by the Spirit of God.
Yeah.
Natural people don't do that. And, you know, we have enough encounters with them to know that that's true.
Yeah.
Amen? So look, it's simple. But it's crucial.
Amen.
People need to know this. There are people that are grieving and worrying and fretting and wondering, and what do I got to do? How do I do this? And, so, and all the time, they're saved, they're full of the Holy Spirit, but they're not living out that reality because they think something else has got to happen. I got to feel something. I got to be the one to get slain in the Spirit, or I got to have, you know, freak out. And there's nothing wrong with any of that. I'm not saying, but that is a physical expression of something that's taking place spiritually, and our physical person sometimes just can't control it. It's like the priest, when the presence of God came into the temple, they were unable to minister. They were just overwhelmed by his presence. Now, that's where we get to the place where we think that has to happen to everybody in order for them to receive the Holy Spirit. It's just not true. Here's another one, John 15 and verse 26. And I've got grandkids, and they've never been exposed to the Pentecostal kind of church that, you know, a lot of us identified with when we were younger or when we got saved. And even though we talked to them that if you accepted Christ, my youngest daughter was baptized in a bathtub. And, you know, I mean, you don't need all the stuff that we think of as being, you know, church for people to get saved. People that get saved in the bathroom, you know, in a bar. I mean, it happens anywhere. God's every place. It can happen wherever a person's heart is open to that. And there doesn't have to be a specific kind of way that they respond to it. Everybody's different. All of our personalities are unique to ourselves. And so to think that everybody's good, God saves us individually. It's a personal relationship.
Amen.
And so he deals with us personally. He doesn't expect there to be a robotic kind of one size fits all, and everybody's got to do the same thing and act the same way in order for it to be a reality. So when the Comforter has come, whom I will send unto you from the Father, even the Spirit of truth, which proceedeth from me, the Father, he shall testify of me.
Yes.
Nobody comes to the Lord except by the Holy Spirit. The Bible says that. That's what he's talking about here. When people come to the Lord, it's because the Holy Spirit's dealing with them.
Yep.
Amen?
Yes.
So it's not possible to say and to mean that Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. It's his job to lead people to Jesus. Praise the Lord. It's a sign of him living in you when you're feeling, I want to follow the Lord. Now, it doesn't mean you're doing it perfectly. I haven't found anybody yet like that. But it means you want to. There's a part of you that wants to follow Christ, that wants to be the person that he's declared us to be. And if you acknowledge Jesus to be your Lord and Savior, it's because the Holy Spirit is at work in you.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Romans chapter 8 and verse 5. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. So when we have been filled with the Holy Ghost, we begin to care about the things that the Spirit cares about. In other words, spiritual things, which is everything we talked about in here this morning. It doesn't mean you don't like barbecue ribs anymore or, you know, a glass of wine. That's not what we're talking about. He's talking about the things of the Spirit now have your attention where they didn't have it before. Right? You start looking for God in situations and circumstances because you believe that he is and that he's a rewarder of them who diligently seek him. Amen? So, don't freak out if your desire ebbs and flows. We talked about this morning. It ebbs and flows because of the life that we're living, the world that we live in, and the circumstances and situations. top all the time. I mean, I'd love to just really be in the spirit and just going for it. But I got to tell you, it don't work that way. I get up some mornings and I really don't even want to get out of bed. I go back to bed, except Sally's still there, and I keep her awake by moaning and groaning. But I'm just saying, you know what I mean? Some days you just think, well, this would be, it'd be good to get past this step, just get to the next one, you know? Amen? So you can't freak out just because you're not feeling like the super saint 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. I mean, it would be wonderful if it were true, but the fact is we live in a fallen world, and we are affected by it. Amen? And so some people live with this fear. It's normal to have ebbs and flows. I'm not saying it's the priority. It's not the thing that we're after. It's just a reality. Look at Romans chapter 7, and we'll read verses 17 through 25. Paul, I mean, we think of Paul and think, man, hey, I wish I had that kind of an experience. I'd like to be that kind of a Christian, right? Well, Paul tells us, then it's no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. He's talking about junk that's happening in his life, his reaction to certain situations and circumstances. And he says, but I've come to the conclusion that when I'm acting like a fool, it's not me that's acting like a fool anymore. Amen? But it's sin that's in me that's acting like the idiot. Amen? And so I know that in me, that's in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing. You might as well settle that. As long as we're on this planet, this thing is a mess.
Yes.
No matter how hard we try to make it good, it still fouls up. It still screws up. Amen? Because in my flesh dwelleth no good thing. For to will is present with me. In other words, I want to do the right thing. I mean, I get up and my attitude is, I'm going to live for the Lord, I'm going to do it right. But how to perform that which is good, I have a problem finding sometimes.
Yeah.
Amen? For the good that I would, I don't. In other words, for the thing that I want to do, I don't get it done. Amen? But the thing that I don't want to do, the evil which I would not do, that's what I end up doing.
Yeah.
Can anybody say praise the Lord? Does that happen to anybody? Amen? So now if I do what I don't want to do, it's not me that's doing it, but it's the sin that dwells in this mortal body, in this flesh. Amen? I find then that there's a law that when I would do good, evil is present with me. For I delight in the law of God after the inward man. So there's a law that deals with the outward man. Amen? The natural laws, in other words, do me wrong and I'm going to do you wrong twice. I'm going to get you good. Amen? You know what I'm saying? Do unto others before they get a chance to do it to you. That kind of stuff. And that's the law that's in our members. That's the natural man, the kind of the predatory alpha, you know, get control and manipulate, do whatever you got to do just to keep the crap off of you, put it on somebody else, get the attention away from you, whatever it might be. So bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members. Oh, wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then with the mind, I myself serve the law of God, but with the flesh, the law of sin. I mean, that's everybody's life.
Yeah.
That's everybody's reality to some degree or another.
Yeah.
Amen? And so some people live with this quiet fear that they are the only Christians who don't have the Spirit living inside. And if that's you, be at peace. Praise the Lord. Yeah. To put it simply, if you want to follow Jesus, you do, or you wouldn't be here. That's the result of God's Spirit inside of you. That's the reality of God being in you. Praise the Lord. Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. And that can be translated in the spirit realm. So, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the Spirit. Amen? In Christ. Now, I don't know about you, but I've heard this many times. It goes all the way back to when I first got saved, or as an adult. And some people would say, well, receiving the Holy Ghost is the second blessing. Anybody ever hear that? I mean, you get saved, so praise the Lord. That's the blessing. And then there's a second blessing, and that's the receiving of the baptism of the Holy Spirit.
Mm.
It's separate and distinct, amen, from from the initial salvation. Well, do I believe in the second blessing? Yes. It happens right between the first and the third.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. We've received everything in Christ. When you accept Christ, you've got the whole package. There's nothing more to get. It's a question of us understanding how to respond to that and how to work through that. Amen. It isn't that there's another thing going to happen. That keeps people always pushing it off into the future, perpetuating this lie that there's something outside of Jesus that's going to change you, that's going to make you special, more anointed, more powerful, more gifted, whatever it might be. Amen. But we can be filled, amen, or you might even say aware or conscious of the Holy Spirit's presence, not just once, but over and over and over and over and over. How many of y'all, you've had experiences in prayer or in a meeting or privately or whatever where the Spirit just came over you, amen, and you prayed in tongues or you weeping or you're just talking to the Lord and thanking God. What? That's another infilling. That's another making you aware that He's here with you, that He'll never leave you or forsake you. It's not like you never had the Holy Spirit before. It's the Holy Spirit that's acting out in you to make you aware of His presence.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. So you can. It happens over and it can happen multiple times. It can happen as many times as you want to take the time to spend, amen, with the Lord. Now, John chapter 20, verses 21 and 22. And I'm going to show you this by the scripture. Jesus is talking to His disciples, and He said to them again, "Peace be unto you." Now, this is before, this is after His death, but it's before the Acts 2. It's before the outpouring, if you will, of the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost. So Jesus to them again, "Peace be unto you. As my Father has sent me, even so send I you." And when He had said this, He breathed on them, and He saith unto them, "Receive ye the Holy Ghost." Think all the way back to the garden, that word is the same word, only it's a Greek translation rather than the Hebrew translation, which is in Genesis, where God breathed on Adam and He kindled something in him, or He brought, made something come alive. And
Amen.
That's exactly the same thing that Jesus, the same language Jesus is using here. It's the same God. Amen. But now He's breathing on multiple men.
Yes.
Amen. And He's saying, "Receive life, God life." Adam had no life. The only life he could have gotten was God's life, because God was God that breathed into him. Amen? And he gave it up. He turned it loose of it because of his unbelief. Right? So look at Acts chapter 1, verses 4 and 5 now. "Being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which saith he, ye have heard of me. For John truly baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence." Well, some of them had already gotten the Holy Ghost. But either that or Jesus is lying when He says He breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit."
Wow.
Praise the Lord. Now, so what I'm saying is, I'm just perpetuating this. I'm just trying to get you to realize there could be multiple fillings of the Holy Spirit. We've kind of got this idea that it's all going to be like the upper room thing, and that's not true. I was just listening to something on TV today. God, when God's presence came to the temple, what happened? There was fire above it, and there was smoke without within. The same thing that happened when Moses saw His glory. The glory of God is the Holy Spirit. It is the Spirit of God.
Amen.
How come, you know, when we come to the new covenant then, it's like fire shut up in my bones. I think it was Nehemiah, or one of them said Jeremiah maybe. It's like fire shut up in my bones. We know that God is a consuming fire. We've always thought of that. It's put out. He's going to burn you. He's going to torture you. No, He's saying He is the fire of life. He is the essence of this thing. And on the day of Pentecost, when they received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, what did it say? It was like tongues of fire over them. It was the glory of God. It was the Spirit of God coming to those people. Now, that was symbolic. It was a way of us identifying with the Old Testament God being the same God, just the means by which He had to operate were limited based on the law.
Mm.
Praise the Lord. So, even after this amazing experience of Pentecost, on the day of Pentecost, the Spirit was poured out like a rushing mighty wind. Even after that happened, the disciples continued to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Amen. Look at Acts chapter 4 and verse 31. place was shaken where they were assembled together. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and they spake the word of God with boldness. This is, who knows, weeks, months, whatever, after the initial outpouring on the day of Pentecost. These same disciples are gathered together, and they're praying, and they're trying to figure out how they're going to do this. They're scared. There's the law, the Roman law, and the Pharisees and so forth. They're still trying to, they'll still kill them if they get a chance. And so they're filled with the Holy Ghost, and they spoke the word of God with boldness. The Holy Spirit came on them, and they had the boldness to declare the word of God in spite of the situation that they found themselves in.
Yeah.
All right? Acts, is that Acts 4:31?
Yeah.
So then Paul writes to, in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 18 here. Chapter 5, verse 18. Be not drunk with wine wherein is excess, but be filled with the Holy Spirit. Now the translation for that, the literal translation is, go on being filled with the Spirit. So he's saying, don't be crazy. Don't get carried away with your drinking. But be continually filled with the Holy Spirit. So he's using it the same as we would think of as alcoholism or being addicted. You just can't quit it. You just can't stop. I want more. No matter how much I get, I want some more, right?
Yes.
And that's what he's saying, the Holy Spirit. That's the way we're supposed to think about the Holy Spirit. Amen. Not just one for the road, right? I'll take a bottle to go. Alright? I mean, I know that's a lousy metaphor, but it's still the truth. He's telling us the same way people crave after the things that they're addicted to is the way we should be craving the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
We should have the same kind of addictive attitude towards God filling us, being drunk in the Spirit. You know, we've all heard it. Amen. Some of us have actually experienced it. So in John 20, verse 22, Jesus breathed on his disciples and he says, receive ye the Holy Ghost. And here's what the scripture is teaching us. With every breath of God, with every awareness that we have of the Holy Spirit or refilling or however you want to define it, amen, with every breath of God, something takes place in every person that God breathes on. Whether they speak in tongues or fall out or shake or anything, there's something happening, amen, every time God breathes on us. Amen. They're no longer left in the, they're not in the Adam dominion anymore. In other words, when that happens, how many of you know you can forget about the natural world for a few seconds or for a few minutes? It's like it doesn't even exist. It's like all just you and God or just you in the moment. And that's what he's saying. He lifts us to the place where we're no longer dominated by our Adamic nature. Amen. The Spirit takes over and we recognize that we're something more than this fallen man. Praise the Lord. And that's what the Holy Spirit is for, to lead us to Jesus, to open our eyes, to show us things to come.
Amen.
Amen. Woo. Lift it up. Praise God. High and lift it up.
Yes.
Amen. And I saw his train fill the temple. He wants to lift us up with him to where
Amen.
We see his train fills the temple, to where we see his glory, amen, dominates everything. Amen. Praise the Lord. From the natural to the spiritual, from the amen, from the earthly realm to the supernatural realm. That's God's nature being manifested. Jesus said, when you see me, you see the Father.
Yes.
He was filled with the Holy Spirit, right?
Yes.
Amen. So God loves to take the people, the ones that the world looks at in a natural way and sees them as failures.
Yeah.
Sees them incapable, limited, weak, whatever. And God says to them the same thing he said to Gideon. You mighty man of valor.
Woo.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Gideon says, wait a minute, Lord, you got me confused with somebody else because I come from the poorest family of the 12 tribes. He was from the tribe of Manasseh, I believe it was. And he said, and I'm the least of this family. So you got the worst bunch, and I'm the worst of that bunch. And you're calling me something special? Right? Judges chapter 6, we'll give you the verse, but he says, and the Spirit of the Lord came on Gideon. Now, he couldn't be filled with the Holy Spirit because of the dispensation he was in, but the Holy Spirit came on him as close as he could be, amen, to being filled with the Holy Spirit. And you know the story. He whips up on these Midianites and drives them out of the country and destroys their armies and the influence that they were having on Israel. He did a great work. He was nothing. He was nobody. But with presence of God, with the Spirit of God, he became this mighty man of valor. He became this person that everybody looked to and thought, man, I'd just love to be like Gideon. The same guy, weeks before, was hiding, amen, from the Midianites, so afraid they were going to come steal his grain. And the next thing you know, he's going out with 300 men to whip their rear end, amen. And he did it. He did it. Actually, he didn't do it, but God did it because of his belief in what God said he would do. And now, if that's not being led by the Spirit, I don't know what is. Because you know our natural mind says, oh, come on, Lord, you know me. I screw up constantly. How are you going to use me? How are you going to make this happen with me? And God's saying, quit defining yourself by yourself and let me be the definition of who you are and what you are. That's what the Holy Spirit does. It gives us a whole new reality. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. So, the Spirit of the Lord. He said that the sword and the Spirit of the Lord. Mary, I got to say again. The sword and the Spirit of the Lord. That's all Gideon needed. The Word of God and the Spirit of God. And no weapon formed against him did prosper. No enemy, no matter how big they were, no matter how large they were, no matter how intimidating they might have been, could not stand before this man, amen, who had the Spirit of the Lord on him and the sword of the Spirit. You know, here, the deal is, we're earthen vessels. I've taught this plenty of time. You think, well, you know, he's trying to make me feel good. No, I'm trying to make me feel good. Praise the Lord. I'm not preaching to you or at you. I'm preaching from me, from my own experiences, from my own life. Look, nobody screws up any more than I do. God doesn't pick people because they're perfect. If he did, Jesus would have had to come in the first place. And not only that, but if he was only picking perfect people, Jesus would be the only one that ever got picked. Praise the Lord. It's because we're in him that God chooses to look at us as though we were him. His literal offspring. That's hard. It's hard for us to imagine because we know ourselves so well. Amen? No matter how powerful an encounter that we have with the Spirit, we're always going to need to go on being filled. I don't know about anybody else. I've had some powerful times in the Lord that have been extremely satisfying and uplifting and encouraging. But I can tell you within a week, some crap's going to happen that's going to cause me to be just like the Israelites and say, where are you, Lord? Did you bring me out here to kill me? Or, you know, what's up? You forget.
Yeah.
And that's why life just keeps throwing crap at you, and you've got to continue to be filled. You've got to keep looking to him, amen, for the answer, because the devil will try to overwhelm you with all the junk that is natural and real in terms of this physical world. But it's not the fact. It's just, it may be a fact, but it's not the truth.
Right.
The truth is Jesus and his word. The facts keep us confused and disappointed and depressed and bummed out and angry and all the other things that go along with it. Amen. We're going to face new crap tomorrow.
Yeah.
I don't like thinking about it. I don't want to dwell on it. I don't want to spend the rest of this day and lose this day because of something that might happen tomorrow. He said that the evil of the day will take care of itself. There's enough crap for each day. We don't need to try to, right? I mean, we don't have to deal with tomorrow because we're not there yet. Let's just deal with today. Let's enjoy the day we've got, and then we'll deal with tomorrow.
Yes.
His grace will be sufficient to deal with us. Amen?
Yes,
praise the Lord. Luke chapter 11, 9 through 13. Luke 11, verses 9 through 13. I wish every believer, everybody who ever wanted to follow God could understand this. You've got everything that God, he has given you all things that pertain to life in God. You may not have the theology all down. You may not be able to quote the verses. But in you, you know. I believe God. I love God. I'm not perfect at this loving. We're not perfect at the love that we deal with here on earth. How can we be perfect at a love that we can't even comprehend? I mean, and God understands that. But it's our desire to love him that is accounted to us as love. Praise the Lord. And I say unto you, ask and it will be given. Seek and you'll find. Knock and it will be opened unto you. For everyone that asks receives. He that seeketh findeth. And to him that knocketh it shall be opened. And if you want to know my opinion, I think he's talking about the Holy Spirit. This isn't about trying to get God to do something for us. He's already given us all things that pertain to life in God. The Spirit. Now, that means that we have to believe it. We have to take some authority and confess some things. Spirit in you, or God makes his abode in you. It's all the same thing. That's why Israel had it figured out. She says, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one." Now, we understand the manifestations, and I'm not denying that, but I'm just saying, it's just one. So whatever you got in you is God.
Yeah.
It's either God, if you want to define it as the Spirit of God, then it is the Spirit of God. There's no question about it. It's Jesus who embodied the presence of God and the Spirit of God in this earth. We don't have a physical Jesus living in us, but we have the same Spirit that was in Christ is in us. Amen. So, it's free. You don't earn it. You can stay at the altar till hell freezes over, and you won't earn the Holy Spirit. But you can just sit there and say, "I believe that Jesus Christ is Lord, and he died for my sins," and you have the Holy Spirit. Whether you ever choose to speak in tongues or to activate that Spirit within yourself is a whole other ballgame. But you still have it. It's just like healing. We receive healing. Amen. By his stripes we were healed. Now, not everybody believes in healing, but it doesn't make healing untrue. Praise the Lord. They just don't ever activate it. They never take advantage of it. It's the same way we've got denominations who do not believe in speaking in tongues because they don't believe. They think that that's some kind of blasphemy, that there's another experience. And that's partly the fault of religion for not explaining these things in the first place. Yeah. My sister that passed away a few years ago never spoke in tongues. That woman had more of the Spirit of God in her than most Pentecostals that I ever been around. She was dedicated, committed to God. Loved the Lord and lived her life expressing that. But she never spoke in tongues. Did that make her less saved? Did it make it impacted her ability to impact others possibly because she didn't operate in the fullness of what she had received. But she still had it. Amen?
Amen.
How can we say that we've been cleansed if the Spirit won't come to us and live in us? That's why we get saved. Not because our sin is a big issue for God, but God's not going to dwell in the same place where sin is. So he has to get to our spirit. How does he do that? By cleansing us of all unrighteousness, then makes his home or his abode righteous, holy, perfect, sinless. Amen? So I'm saying that if it's a free gift, then by definition, it has absolutely no relation to our qualities, to our achievements, to our niceties, amen. When it comes to the question of merit, the only person whose merit matters is Jesus. He did it all.
Amen.
He made it possible for us to not do anything except to believe and have God's presence. So, I mean, here the deal is there's no Pentecost without the cross. There could be. There could be no outpouring of the Spirit because the Spirit comes from the cross. Look at John 7, verse 37 through 39. John 7, 37 through 39. Just some more scriptures to validate this. In the last days, the great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried, saying, "If any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. He that believeth on me, as the Scripture has said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. But this he spake of the Spirit." So he's not talking about water. He's talking about the Spirit. The water simply is symbolic of the Holy Ghost, which they that believe on him should receive. For the Holy Ghost was not yet given because that Jesus was not yet glorified. The cross is where the Holy Spirit comes from. Amen? John 16, verse 7. "Nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, I will send him unto you." All right? John 19, verse 30. So Jesus is on the cross, and when Jesus therefore had received the vinegar, he said, "It is finished," and he bowed his head and gave up the ghost. Now, the literal translation for that is he handed over the Spirit. Praise the Lord. That's what was happening in those last seconds on the cross. And the next thing that you read is the soldier pierces Jesus' side, and it brings a sudden outpouring of blood and water. Amen? John 19, verse 34. water symbolizes the Spirit being poured out. Praise the Lord. 1 John chapter 5, verses 6 through 10. This is he that came by water and blood, even Jesus Christ. Not by water only, but by water and blood. It is the Spirit that beareth witness, because the Spirit is truth. Now listen carefully. For there are three that bear record in heaven: the Father, filling, continually filling the Holy Spirit is about. It's not about another, I got to do this to get saved again. No, you're saved. You're good. But you need the Lord God, because life keeps throwing spitballs, you know, and it keeps throwing curves, and we've got to be prepared for it. And the Holy Spirit's the only one who can do that. Amen?
Amen.
Romans chapter 8, verse 14. Might want to check that text message, dude. Could be worth some money.
I was kind of waiting for a text message. I never got one.
Well, who knows after we got it. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. Okay, Galatians 5, and verse 18. If you be led of the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now, Jesus described the Spirit as like a wind that blows where it wills. He said that we don't know where it comes from. We don't necessarily know where it's going. We can't catch. You can't domesticate or control the Spirit. You can't do it. It's not something... I've heard this said before, but I'll just use it too. It's not so much us getting more of the Spirit as it is the Spirit getting more of us.
Yeah.
And that's where the confession of the Word, that's where the constantly, our reset has to be back to God. You know, not back to the last jump that happened or the thing that's, you know, pending to take place, but back to God. Amen? So, Luke chapter 11, verses 11 and 12. We read this before, but it's, again, God is telling us, you know, you being evil know how to give good things to your kids, you know. If he asks for an egg, you're not going to give him a scorpion, right? But if he shall ask an egg, will he offer him a scorpion? Here's what he's telling us. There is no stain with the gifts that God gives us. In other words, whatever you're getting from God is all good. It's not bringing any evil. It's not bringing any negative. The negative is coming from the world around us, from the enemy, and he is the Lord of the air. He's the God of this world. Not our God, because we're in this world, we're just not of this world. But the people who are of this world, he's their God. He controls. Amen? But God, our God, gives us nothing that has a stain to it. Amen? That's the devil. He'll give you some shiny thing over here or something that you enjoy or you like. But he doesn't tell you that that's going to cause cancer 10 years from now. Or he doesn't tell you that that's going to break up your marriage. Or he doesn't tell you that that's going to ruin your children's lives. He just says, well, God doesn't do that. Anything he gives us is pure, is pristine, is perfect. Amen? No sin. Hallelujah. Luke 11, 9 and 10 now. I know I'm backing it up here for you. I say unto you, ask, and it will be given. You seek, and you'll find. Knock, and it will be opened unto you. For everyone that asks to see Jesus, seek to see to find it, and to him that knocketh, it shall be opened. So the gift of the Holy Spirit is what we're still talking about. Ask. Seek. Find. He'll give it to you. He wants the encounter more than you do. I mean, he gave his life for this relationship. So there's nothing that he won't do. The scripture tells us if, you know, he gave his only begotten son, or he gave his physical life for us, he'll give us all things by that same means. Amen? If he was willing to give us the most precious, the most important thing, then why would we doubt that he'd give us everything else? Or anything else that we need this. Amen? Praise the Lord. So, don't worry. You don't have to focus on seeking a particular type of experience. Because that's what happened. I mean, I know people that I was around when we first got into church and so on and so forth. They were always looking for the next bell ringer, you know, some really bizarre, strange, out, you know, something. And that's not what this is about. We're not supposed to be seeking a particular type of experience. The main thing to remember is that we're seeking God's presence. That's the experience that he's wanting us to have. The other stuff will just happen. It'll take care of itself. We don't need to try to, you know, jump off of buildings or walk on water. What we need is God. He'll take care of it if we need to walk on water or if we need to survive and jump off of a building. His laws will prevail. But we need him more than we need the experience. Amen?
Amen.
You've got the Spirit living in you. It's normal Christian life to be supernatural. It's the gift of God. It's his genealogy given to us, his life given to us. Amen? 1 Corinthians 12, verse 1. simply means spiritual things. Now, concerning spiritual things, brother, I don't want you to be ignorant. We are spirit beings. We should understand the spirit. We should operate in the spirit. That's what I said. I don't want you to be like uneducated or unable to understand how life works. Right? You have the spirit. You should live by the spirit. And it's a gift from God. Gifts that you don't earn. You can't earn a gift. It's God's power that's freely given to us. All of these things, now you can go down the list of whether it's tongues, whether it's interpretation of tongues, whether it's healing, laying on of hands, whether it's financial breakthrough, it doesn't make any difference. He's given us power in every one of these circumstances, in every one of these situations. It's freely given to us, to normal, weak people, so that we can be effective in bringing about his kingdom. Right? That's what God said. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth. That's what we have the Spirit for, is to make that happen. Praise the Lord. It's about his kingdom, his domain ruling in this realm. Praise the Lord. Amen. 1 Corinthians 12, verses 12 through 14. For as the body is one and hath many members, and all the members of that one body being many are one body, so also is Christ. For by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body, whether we be Jews or Gentiles, whether we be bond or free, and have been all made to drink into one Spirit. Praise the Lord. You know, again, it's what Don was saying before. There's a lot of gifts, multiple gifts. We don't need all the gifts all the time. We just need the gift that we need at that particular time. It's the same way with the body. He said, just like the gifts are, they all one. They all come from the same Spirit. The body is the same way. The reason for the gifts and the reason why they are distributed individually, not that we have access to all of them. Each one of us do. But normally it doesn't work that way. You don't get up one day and just you heal somebody and you do this and you do the other. That's why we have a body that comes together. He said, everybody's not the foot. Everybody's not the hand, everybody's not the head, but that's not a bad thing because you need the foot. The head's not going anywhere without a foot, right? The head can't do anything unless it has a hand to get the things for. So we, and some days I'm the foot, some days I'm the hand, some days I'm other parts of the anatomy. Praise the Lord. That are listed here. But you understand what I'm saying? We need one another. Just like we need all the gifts to function, we need one another in order for those gifts to function. To really understand God, I need Rita. I need Don. I need Mary. I need Roy. Right? It takes all of us to make Jesus functional in this world. That's what he's telling us. Amen? Praise the Lord. Now, here's the deal. Can you bring up 14 there, Tim? Peter?
Yeah.
For the body is not one member, but many. Right? So now he tells us that we are the temple of God, right? Now I read just a brief portion from Revelation, but here's my feeling, and you can disagree or agree, however, it doesn't really matter to me, but I think the temple in Revelation is the same temple that the New Testament is talking about. It's us. Praise the Lord. 1 Corinthians 6, verse 19. See all the symbolism that that we see and talk about all through the old, the Bible, Old Testament, through the New Testament. Revelation is just an extension of that. So all of a sudden we want to take it literally when everything else we've taken symbolically. I mean, we understand there's literal truth to that, but the symbolism is just to help us understand that truth. And Revelation is no different as far as I'm concerned. So he says, what? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which you have of God, and you are not your own. So what does God do? Why does God need a temple? Because that's where he works from on this earth. He had to have his dwelling place. And that's why he had David with the tabernacle and then eventually evolved into the temple. Why? Because God needed access to the earth. Right? He's illegal to just be out here running around taking over stuff. But if he has a temple where people invite him to come and dwell, He is legal to be there. Amen? And that's why the temple existed in the first place. Praise the Lord. And so, what does God do from the temple? That's where he operates from. That's where he sends out his ministers. Right? It's from the temple and the tabernacle that God ministered through the priests and through the, you know, the temple system and the sacrificial system and all of that. That's where he operated. Well, he does the same thing today. He's got to have a temple. And we are that temple. And we are the means by which he's going to speak and act. It's that simple. That's why he comes and lives in us. We have that same fire, that same reality that they had under the old covenant, only now it's dwelling not in buildings made with hands, amen, but in humanity itself.
Yep.
Praise the Lord. He speaks and acts through you and me. Acts chapter 2, verses 16 through 21 here. Acts 2, 16 through 21. But this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. And it shall come to pass in the last days. Now, he's saying this when the Holy Spirit's being poured out. He's coming. What you're seeing is what was prophesied.
Yeah.
So he said, this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. And it will come to pass in the last days, saith God, that I will pour out my spirit. I'm going to tell you something. That last days, you know what that is? It's the end of the age. And what that end of the age is the end of the law. It's not talking about that was the last day, because obviously we're still here. He was talking about that age or that time where the law prevailed is over. It has ended. Amen. That, and it shall come to pass in the last days, and after the law, the legal Jewish traditional system has passed away, I'm going to pour out my spirit. Because you won't have the high priest, and you won't have the sacrificial system, and you won't have the rules and the laws to obey, but you're going to have the spirit to lead you and guide you. I'm going to put my laws in your heart. Amen. And in your mind. And he does it by the Holy Spirit. We know right from wrong. Doesn't mean we always choose to go along with it, but we do know. Amen. And upon all the flesh, and your sons and your daughters will prophesy, your young men will see visions, your old men will dream dreams. And on my servants and on my handmaidens, I'll pour out in those days of my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I'll show wonders in heaven above and signs in the earth beneath, blood and fire and vapor of smoke. Praise the Lord.
Wow.
Hallelujah.
Wow.
Amen. Ephesians 1, verses 13 and 14. We're in that day. This is the last day. We've been in the last days. Amen. For a long time. The old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. In whom you also trusted after that you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also after that you believed, you were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. This is the great good news, because we all screw up. We've talked about it, and I've been dwelling on it, and we all know that we have these issues. But look, I can't, no matter how much I screw up, I can't be no longer filled with the Holy Spirit. It cannot stop. It will not. Nothing. I cannot undermine with all of my idiocy what God has already done.
Yes.
Because I've been sealed.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Remember in Revelation when he said, if you become an overcomer, and Jesus has overcome, made us more than overcomers, he said, I'm going to make you a pillar. In other words, I'm going to make you a focal point or a major source of the structure, amen, or the temple where God dwells, amen, amen. And I'm going to put a new name on you. I'm going to seal you with a new name. I'm going to put my name in your forehead. It's the Holy Spirit that he's talking about. We've been sealed. I don't know that you'll ever see 666 across somebody's head or that you'll see God's name on my forehead, but I'm telling you, I've been sealed. And everything, just because you can't see it, doesn't make it unreal.
Yeah.
Amen. We have all been sealed. In other words, when you seal something, what do? You get it to where nothing can get out of it, right? So the Holy Spirit is not going to leave. You cannot leave you because you've been sealed with it.
Wow.
Praise the Lord. Now, I get it. We are earthen vessels. And we leak. But not my spirit. It's been sealed. That Holy Spirit and my spirit are one. They're the same. They're identical and could not be separated. All right, so after that, you believe you were sealed, which is the earnest of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession under the praise of his glory. What's the purchased possession? This, the flesh, the physical world that we live in, it's all going to be redeemed. But in the meantime, we've been given an earnest or a down payment on the final thing. And that down payment is the Spirit dwelling in us that tells us, hey, I know it's a bunch of crap here, but it's going to get better. It's all good in the end. It's all going to be good, James. It's all good. No matter how bad it looks, it's still good. Praise the Lord. Because I'm never going to leave you or forsake you. Amen. I'm your God. You're my child. Praise the Lord. Amen. The earnest of our inheritance is the down payment that's been made. And it was made by Jesus himself.
Yes.
Amen. We've been sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. And that seal is God's guarantee of the Spirit of God being in us and working in our lives.
Amen.
That's the promise. That's
Amen.
The guarantee. The seal is God's promise of greater things to come.
Yes.
I don't know how high of an experience you've had in the Holy Spirit. God saying, you haven't tasted the thing. There's so much more. There's so much more I want to do. There's so much more I want you to experience. And I'm not just talking about in heaven. I'm talking about here and now. And the more we're aware of his presence, the more we experience that presence. And that's what the whole point in this message is. Most of y'all probably know all this stuff anyway. But I get these questions, and I want people to know, there's nothing more. You just need to start activating what you've already got. You need to start living out of your true worth and your true identity and what God has declared you to be. That'll set people free quicker than anybody waving hands over them. Anointing them with oil. I'm not against that. It's biblical. But I'm just saying it puts too much emphasis on the person doing it rather than the person who paid for it.
Yeah.
Amen? And that's the Lord. And we need to understand that because you're not always going to have somebody to pray for you. You're not always going to have the anointed so-and-so with somebody else. You're going to have to realize, hey, I'm anointed as anybody, and if I want this thing to happen, I'm going to have to believe God for it myself. Praise the Lord. And as always is the case, the enemy will immediately come and say, you?
Yeah.
Give me a break. You better get on the hotline and find somebody to get over here because you're such a screw-up. All you're going to do is make a fool out of yourself. No, you're the answer that God has for that particular situation and circumstance. You wouldn't be there. Amen. We'll wrap it up with this. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 1 through 14. The seal is the confirmation of God's abiding presence. And with that presence comes protection. I've said it many times. He's our shield and exceeding great reward. Not only does he protect us, but he gives us the protection. Gives us exceeding, way more. Amen?
Amen.
So Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, to the saints which are at Ephesus, and to the faithful in Jesus Christ, or in Christ Jesus. Grace be to you, and peace from God our Father, and from the Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. According as he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. You think God didn't know what we were going to deal with this week? He knew you and everything about you before the foundation of the world. Before any of your ancestry outside of Adam had even existed. In fact, before Adam. Which tells you your true identity or your true ancestry is God himself.
Amen.
Everybody else was just a means. God to give you.
Yeah.
Having predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will. So it's not, we're not twisting God's arm. This is his good pleasure. This is the thing he wanted. This is what he was after from the very beginning, before the foundation. Amen. To the praise and the glory of his grace, wherein he hath made us accepted in the beloved. How did he make us accepted? By grace, by the gift of grace. In whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace, wherein he hath abounded toward us in all wisdom and prudence, having made known unto us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he had purposed in himself, that in the dispensation of the fullness of times he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth, even in him. In whom also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestinated according to the purpose of him who worked all things after the counsel of his own will. That we should be to the praise of his glory, who first trusted in Christ. In whom ye also trusted, after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also after that ye believed, you were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise, which is the earnest of our inheritance, until the redemption of the purchased possession unto the praise of his glory. Before the foundation of the world, God had this plan.
Yeah.
Amen. It's not new. It's not. Nothing's changed. It works.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. If you believe, you've been sealed with the Holy Spirit. sharing your testimonies, your prayer requests. Love you all. Have a great week.